Good day, everybody. I wanted to talk about this programmable integrated circuit, PIC. This is an old name made by the microchip company. It's the actual name of the company. And it is basically a computer on a chip, they call it. And you can write programs for it and make this this component do almost anything. Project here I'm going to talk about is basically a cooling fan controller for a car engine. I'll get back more to that in a minute, but if you've ever designed electronic circuits and come up with the drawings for what it's supposed to do, and I'm not a professional with this isn't my job, this is just a hobby. I can come up with the basics. I can design the output, controlling a relay, can design simple resistor networks, simple stuff I can do no problem. And plus I have the internet, I can look up basic designs. And I use nothing exotic in this design. All these parts, except for the PIC chip, are available from Radio Shack. And this one page, this is the entire thing. The car is an Oldsmobile diesel, and it did not have any sort of engine ECM. It only had basic electrical switches. And it had four temperature controlled switches that would activate the engine diesel injection pump fast idle timing advance when it was cold, two speeds for the cooling fan, radiator fan, high and low, and then a temperature warning light if the engine got too hot. And those switches were old and no good anymore, and plus the factory had set the cooling fan temperatures insanely hot, and the engines were getting damaged because of that. So I wanted to run the cooling fan at a lower temperature. And the switches are not adjustable, so I needed a solution that could be adjusted. On all the newer cars, you have an engine ECM, which has a temperature sensor, and the engine ECM controls these functions. And it simply reads the coolant temperature from one sensor and activates its different outputs. The diesel doesn't have an engine ECM, but I wanted to use a sensor, one sensor to control all this, so that's why I decided to use this programmable controller, because it is going to read a standard Delphi temperature sensor, and it's going to activate outputs and control the car's original fan relay and cold advance, high idle, and warning light, just like the four separate switches, but it's going to do it all in one unit. So that's my reasoning behind this. Now I'll get into some of the details of building it. Okay, I got the tripod set up there. Hope I can manage to do some good and not bump it. But this sensor is nothing more than a resistor. You can measure it with the ohm meter, which I have there on the table. Plug in the connector. So got a complete sensor and connector. Maybe that's readable, I hope. Tie these wires on there, I'll get a temperature reading. 2.9 K ohms. Now you see that temperature, the resistance is dropping. All I'm doing is just touching it, warming it up. And it's got a very precise temperature to resistance chart. It's provided by the manufacturer. And based on that chart, we can set the set points where the fan and the lights and the things are going to turn on and off. All right, can't watch the camera display and the computer at the same time, so maybe this will work, maybe it won't. I have the data sheet from Delphi on the temperature sensor. You can see there. It tells you the dimensions, the thread size, all the stuff you need to know. Tells you it's cost effective, robust, trying to sell it. All the thermal and mechanical details. But here it gets interesting. This is showing the recommended circuit to apply this sensor. And in my circuit here, don't know if it's going to show up. I've used almost the same thing, but I've put a few more parts in there to protect my programmable circuit from any kind of stray voltage. It's just this basic design, but a little more safer. And then if I keep scrolling down, we'll get to the resistance chart. And this is where it's important. Have your temperature, degrees C, and the resistance in ohms. So if you want something to happen at a given temperature, pick for instance, you want it to happen at 100 degrees C, you look at the resistance, that's 180.3 ohms. So you would design a circuit that's measuring that resistance and it does its job at 180.3 ohms. And that is exactly what this is going to do. It's going to have more than one set point in it, but it's going to be using numbers from this chart to do its work. As for the programmable controller, I have its data sheet here too, made by a microchip company. These have been around for a long time, but a lot of people don't know about them. It's very inexpensive. That's about a $4 chip, and it can do the job of $50 or $60 worth of discrete components if you know how to apply it. And this tells you all the specs on it, and this is showing the connections to the IC. This pin right here is an analog input that will measure voltage, and that is what's going to be reading the sensor. Pass a little current through the sensor and read the voltage across it on this input. And this is a 230-page document. No need to go through the whole thing right now. But anything you want to know about this, the memory registers, how to operate it, what to do in your program, function of every pin on it, every little pin on this device has an entry in this document telling exactly what it does. So this document is critical, as is this temperature to resistance chart. And aside from all the programming and wiring, you got to know what the device needs to do. And what I have here is some information about the car itself. The process variable that we're going to be looking at is engine to coolant temperature. And essentially, as the temperature rises, we want different events to happen. And starting from cold, as the temperature rises, according to Oldsmobile, at 113 Fahrenheit, the cold advance should turn off. That's the first event on rising temperature. At about 180 Fahrenheit, the engine coolant thermostat should open, so it should not get much hotter than that. If it continues to go up from above 180, at about 190, I want the low-speed cooling fan to turn on. And if the temperature continues climbing to 195, the fan should switch to high speed. And if it continues climbing to 220 Fahrenheit, then the warning lamp on the dash should come on, telling you there's a problem. So that's what we need to happen. That's the rising temperatures, our variable we're going to monitor with the sensor. And the events that we want to happen are turning off the cold idle, turning on low fan, turning on high fan, and finally turning on the overheat warning. These set points basically came from the service manual for the car. The fan temperatures, I'm changing them lower. They had that high speed coming on at like 240 Fahrenheit, which is way too hot. Each event needs to have a pair of set points, hysteresis pair, we call that. After the wiring and programming is decided upon, got to know what the controller is actually going to do. And in this case, we're controlling things based on the temperature of an engine. The engine is an Oldsmobile 1984 model that had multiple temperature switches that were troublesome and not set at the right points. And so we're going to eliminate all those with this device. So to plan what it's going to do, I've got this chart. Our process variable that we're going to be monitoring is engine coolant temperature. And starting from cold, as the temperature rises, we want certain events to happen at the right temperature. And the first event that should happen at 113 Fahrenheit is the cold idle, high idle, should turn off. Temperature keeps rising. At about 190, radiator fan should come on low speed. If the temperature keeps rising about 195, it should switch to high speed. If it keeps rising at about 220, the warning lamp should come on the dash. So, process variable is engine water temperature, and we have these four different events that happen at these temperatures. In order for this to switch the events on and off consistently, there needs to be a high and a low point for each event, and basically hysteresis pair, meaning the service manual calls for 113 for the cold idle, but you don't want it to try to switch at exactly 113, because that is going to cause it to switch on and off rapidly when it's right at the set point. It's going to go above and below possibly many times a second, and basically the relay will chatter. So it's going to have to hit 115.5 to turn on that function, but if the temperature starts to go down, it'll have to go all the way down to 110.5 to turn it off. So that makes sure once that function happens, it's going to stay happening unless the temperature falls 5 degrees. So we give it a 5 degree hysteresis. And the same for each set point. 2.5 degrees below, 2.5 degrees above the nominal point for each event that happens. And that's a number that's kind of standard for certain things. I just chose to use it. Going back to the temperature sensor, that chart is all in degrees C. So the next column here, I just used the convert program on my laptop and converted the temperatures here from the 84 Olds book. They were not in degrees C. Converted to degrees C and got this column. The chart has every 5 degrees it has an entry, but we're not on 5 degree intervals except for maybe a few points. No, we're not even not on 5 degrees on degrees C for anything. So I had to use an interpolation formula, which you can find online, and it's exactly for this. It lets you take a chart like this where you've got a value in between two of the chart entries, and you need to know what the exact value would be. So for each of these points that I've come up with, like the 43.61 degrees C, using this formula in the sensor chart, I came out with 1,286 ohms. And the same thing for each one. So at this resistance, when the temperature sensor resistance falls to 1,286, then we know we're at this event. When it falls to 1149, it's at this event, and so forth up the chart. Because this controller, it doesn't actually know temperature. It only knows electrical parameters. So we're going to have to give it a voltage and let that voltage tell it where the temperature is. So all this right now is a means to an end. Now, to further work towards that end of letting temperature control electrical things, this programmable controller is going to have to be programmed with useful information to do that. And in order to troubleshoot and design the program, I need to be able to see what's happening inside the computer mind of this little part. And this wire connected to a test point on the board, that is actually going into the back of my laptop on the 9-pin serial port. And it's nothing more than RS-232, like an old school modem or old school, anything old school that connected to the laptop. And I'm actually able to read information from that pin. It's a one-way street from here to the computer and from here into the laptop. But it will let me know what's happening in the program. I don't know if you can see the computer screen or not, but there's a number 63 showing on the screen, and that's actually being read from this this circuit. And I will power it off and back on, and when it powers on, there will be an identification that goes by, and then it's going to scroll off the screen because it's constantly reporting the information that it's receiving from that analog input. And right now there's nothing connected, so it's really low. If I take the sensor, connect it to the circuit there, now I'm getting a different reading. Getting 8447, so now we're getting information from the sensor. And you see, if I hold the sensor and warm it up, now it's going up. 86, 8700, it's still going up. 88. So we're actually seeing the result of this sensor on the laptop screen. So now I'm one step closer. Now I've got an actual number in my program that's changing with the temperature. So now I can work with that number in the computer code and cause it to do things based on that information. We're getting, like I said, one step closer to making something work. But that number is just a number. It doesn't have a unit, it doesn't have a meaning. It's just the counts from the analog to digital converter. And our sensor is given in a chart based on ohms. So we need to relate that ohms resistance to this number. And I have a meter here that's calibrated, measures resistance very accurately. I've got a resistor, variable resistor, in this box, which I will connect up to the meter. And I have a switch here, make sure that's on the screen. The switch is over here, then the meter is able to read the resistance. The switch is in the other position, then these two leads are connected to the resistance in here. So I'm going to take the temperature sensor and take it off and get rid of it. Now my reading on the laptop went back down to 63 because there's nothing hooked up. Hook these leads on here. Now the reading went up to 16,639. So I can change this resistance by turning the little screws in here and change the resistance. Select the meter. I know that our lowest set point for 113 degree is supposed to be 1286 ohms. And you see I've already put adjusted that to 1286. Now I'll switch it over. Now this circuit is reading the 1286 ohm, and now we've got a number of 16,639. So now you see that number represents 1286 ohms, which represents 43.6 degrees C. So now we're actually able to do something at the right point on the chart. And I can let this this programmable circuit memorize that using the setup. And the set point number one is the lowest one, 1286. We've already got it dialed in on there. Push this the button on the board, and it showed me all the existing set points that are programmed already that are probably not right. And it's in mode one, which is to program set point one. We'll press this button for 5 seconds or so. And now it remembered that 16,639. Move on to the next one. Next set point should be 1149 ohms. Try to dial that in. All right, 1149 ohms. Put the same resistance onto the controller. We'll change it to set point 2. Press this button for 5 seconds to memorize set point 2. All right, now set point 2 is saved in the memory. And I'll go on through until all 8 set points are programmed, and then come back and we will test it, function test it. But I'm using a calibrated meter to create a resistance that simulates the desired temperature. And then I'm going to transfer that resistance I've created from the calibrated meter over to the test circuit. And then I'm going to teach this. Remember that resistance, that's where the sensor value is supposed to switch. Simple as that. Well, I've got everything set up here for a function test. All the set points are in. I couldn't find my infrared temperature gun to check the temperature on the sensor. I'll have to eventually check, make sure it's working right that way. But for now, I'm going to test it anyway. These two resistors are basically just for heat. They're hooked up to this power supply I can turn on in a minute. This is hooked up to the output on the controller for the low speed fan. This is hooked up for the high speed fan. This light is the warning light on the dash to tell you the car's too hot. This solenoid and blue light is the cold high idle if it's too cold. So I'm going to turn on the switch. This is a power switch on the power supply simulating turning on the key. Now when I first turn on the key switch, that light should come on for a moment and go off as a self-test. And then the high idle solenoid should kick in. Alright, so far so good. Now start cranking up some heat. Had about 10 amps flowing through those resistors. Crank it down to about 5 so I don't burn them out. Some heat rising up. So far the high idle function is still active. There's not a lot of contact between that resistor and the temperature sensor, so the resistor is going to have to get really hot and it'll take a long time before it heats the sensor up much. It doesn't have to get all that hot to kick out the high idle, so it should just be a moment. I don't know if it'll show on the video, but over here on the laptop screen you can see the numbers going by of the program as it's measuring the rising temperature. Should be warm enough any minute. Oh, high idle just kicked out. Some heat rising off of there. The sensor's just barely warm. It may take it a while before the fans kick in. I'm going to pause the video and come back after it's gotten a little closer to the temperature. Should be getting close now. Low fans on. High fans started. Let's see if those resistors have enough heat to get it overheated to 220 Fahrenheit. I didn't intend it that way, but that fan may actually be affecting it and cooling it off. It's blowing this way. But it could be creating a draft. Imagine that, having to move the fan so it won't do its job. But yeah, the numbers are still rising on the monitor, so it should overheat any minute. The car has a fan relay for the low and the high fan, so this thing will be actually switching a relay coil on and off, but I just happen to have those two little power supply fans just for this demonstration. It definitely doesn't have enough current capacity to run the actual car's radiator fan motor. Oh, now we're overheated. Warning light's on. Not a good sign. Shut down the engine, turn off the resistors. Now, turn this fan around where it blows on the sensor. Cool it off. Well, there's some heat coming off of that. Once it cools down past that the point, overheat point right there, the overheat warning light went off. As it continues to cool down, the high speed fan should stop first, followed by the low speed fan. Alright, high speed fan shut off. Still running on low speed fan. Low speed stopped. And if you wait long enough, the high idle function would kick back in, but that's going to take a really long time because low speed fan cut off at 187, and that will have to go all the way down to 110 before that the high idle comes back. So I'm not going to video that whole wait time. In order to expedite things, I'm going to cheat. I'm going to take some water out of the fridge, it's cold, and dip the sensor in it to rapidly lower the temperature, and then the cold advance and idle, high idle should come back on. Now notice I'm trying not to dip the connector underwater. Still warm. Oh, now we're back to cold high idle. That's the full cycle of the thermal controller, all four of its functions. We'll explain some more about the logic in it in a minute. Now, for my profession, I work on engines and industrial control systems, and we always try to make things, I guess, fail safe, or to be able to manage a failure with the least chance of causing damage. And I put some thought into this to that end too. If the sensor breaks, or the wiring to the sensor breaks, what do you want to happen? And I was, based on past experience, if this sensor breaks and the fan comes on high speed and stays on high speed, that's going to overload the alternator on the car and cause you to lose your alternator after enough time. So you don't want high speed fan all the time if the sensor breaks. So it activates the low speed fan, which that should be enough to keep the car drivable while you troubleshoot, or till you have time to fix the sensor. And I'll demonstrate that too. But right now it's in a cold condition, so the high idle timing advance is on, and that is harmful to the engine if it's fully warmed up and that stays on. So if the sensor breaks, you want to deactivate the high idle timing advance and run the low speed fan. And also, because this car is an old car, there's no diagnostics, no check engine light or anything, the sensor fails, I want the overheat light to flash. So I'm going to simulate that, unplug the sensor. You see the high idle kicked out, and the low speed fan started running and we got a flashing warning light. And I'll plug it back in and it should go back to normal. It's cold, so it goes back to high idle. Now I'll simulate a short circuit in the sensor. If I can make contact, same thing. Flash. So that will help minimize any problems that might arise. It'll let you know what's going on and protect the system a little bit. With the design of the car's fan, it's not two fans like this. It's one fan with a two-speed motor. And that motor is designed to start on low, get up to speed, and then switch to high. So in my program, there's a timer, and the high-speed fan can't turn on until low speed has already been running for 10 seconds or more. That is to protect against too much inrush current on the motor. And that's part of this code. So if for whatever reason the fan, it's in high speed fan, it's hot and it's in high speed fan, and you turn the key off and back on, when it comes on it's going to start low speed and then wait 10 seconds to start high speed. I'll demonstrate that. So now I'm using the resistance simulator so I don't have to heat this up again. And it's high speed fan, two are running, pretending that the car is hot and you're in stop and go traffic, and I'm going to turn off the key. Fans are stopped, but the engine's still hot. I'm going to turn it back on in a minute. You'll notice after the self-test of the light, it's going to start low speed first, allow the fan to get up to speed, and then high speed to protect the motor. And it that's just a timer in the program code. Alright, one last thing. Say for instance you don't have a laptop to hook up to this, you don't have the software, and the set points need to be changed for whatever reason. This switch on here lets you select which set point to save, and it uses the warning light to let you know. I press it one time. I pressed it twice. The double flash, that tells me I'm in set point 2, which is the cutoff position for the high idle. I press it again, we'll move to set point 3. And if I were to press and hold the button for 5 seconds with it in this mode, it would remember the temperature now and put that in set point 3. But I'm not going to do that because I've already got them set the way I want them. And can scroll through to set point 9, which is to restore the original ones. Eight. It's 9. Next one is back to normal. The programming language I've used for this is PBP3. And when I first got into these programs, I don't even know if they had a number. It was just called PBP. And they've improved it a lot. And the old programmer system worked on a printer port, a parallel printer port. And the new programming device now is this. And very simple, USB connects to the chip with these. I use that cable. There's also a socket you can connect to this and directly put the chip on it. And the code itself is based on the BASIC language. It's been around forever. And the way the statements work and the BASIC structure is like the old BASIC programming language, but it is very specialized for use with these microcontrollers. There's a lot of statements that are specific to controlling the output pins and reading the different registers and what have you that aren't part of the original BASIC language. But if you have programmed in BASIC for a PC computer, you would be able to understand how this works. And with any kind of BASIC language programming experience, plus the book, which explains what all the special statements do, to be able to pick up on it.